But you'll basically be writing a game from scratch during the kind of the first half of this tutorial. And then we'll have a break at in about an hour and a half for some tea and coffee, and then we'll come back and do some other stuff. So, if everybody's now got the zip, has anybody not got that zip file? Okay, yep. There's also a USB key floating around with the zip file on it. Just whoever's got that, if they could just put their hand up down the back. You can grab the zip file off of that as well. So, game development in Python. I've given three versions of this talk now. It's not exactly the same game that I develop each time. It's a different game each time. But I've given this tutorial using Pygame and using Piglet, and now I'm doing it using Kivy. So to give some idea of the landscape of Python game development tools, Pygame is by far the oldest of the tools available. It's also by far the most stable and mature. It doesn't change a lot, hasn't changed a lot in 5-10 years, because it's built on top of a very stable library called SDL that's been around for a very long time. Pygame is a very CPU-intensive library. It doesn't utilize modern hardware itself directly. You can use it to write OpenGL applications which use modern hardware, but by default, it's just CPU. You can deploy Pygame games to Android smartphones, but again, very CPU-intensive. So they're not very friendly for mobile applications because they chew up the battery very quickly. Piglet was developed in response to kind of the fact that Pygame had stabilized, had matured. I wouldn't say stagnated, but it had matured. And it has its own way of doing things. Piglet is kind of a new approach of doing things, a different way of handling events, and a different way of interfacing with the operating system, using the operating system more directly and than Pygame, which kind of abstracts things away. It also was written in pure Python, so there was no compilation, which was a big benefit as well. So it could actually run in PyPy. Kivy is the most modern. It's only about 3 or 4 years old. And it's the intention with Kivy was to start thinking about newer user interfaces. So there's this concept called natural user interfaces, which is a concept coined by Microsoft. And it tries to encompass like the whole of touch devices and their Kinect device, and basically a more natural way of interacting with computers rather than bashing away at keys on a keyboard or using a mouse. Kivy's nice because it runs on all of our desktops and it runs on Android and iOS, which is fairly unique for Python Python graphical interfaces. It can be run under Python 2 and 3, although you can't deploy a Python 3 application to the mobile devices yet because the build environment hasn't been... There's still some things to sort out in the build environment. And those are things that have to go right down into the actual Python core development. So there's patches in play for Python core development to apply to Python 3, and then we'll be able to build our applications for the mobile devices using Python 3, which will be really cool. It runs on the Raspberry Pi, so it doesn't need a lot of resources. Because it uses modern hardware, the modern OpenGL hardware, those things are, even the Raspberry Pi has OpenGL hardware in it, so you can push a lot of pixels with very little effort. And it's built on top of OpenGL ES, which is the most modern version of OpenGL, which is kind of a... OpenGL's been around for a good 20 or 25 years now, doing 3D graphics. Well, GL has been around for that long. And OpenGL ES is very much a modernization of the OpenGL API and a simplification of the OpenGL API. Kivy also provides really good hardware to mobile access to mobile hardware. So you can utilize things like the motion sensor and the GPS of a handset. Unfortunately, Kivy doesn't give you access to native widgets on any platform. So whatever user interface you develop, it's going to be using the Kivy widget set. that's not actually that interesting for us because we're developing games and games have their own interface anyway. This is the basic Hello World app in Kivy. There's not a lot of boilerplate. There's not a lot of typing to get a basic graphical user interface up and running. This is pretty much par for most user interface code in Python, regardless of the toolkit. And the Kivy widget layout engine does a pretty good job of making this work. I was going to move this to the end. Oh well. So we're going to cover a lot of stuff today, and you're going to be basically developing the source code for an entire game from the ground up. And it's yours to do what you will with it. You've typed it in, there's no license on it. The other stuff that I've given you, because I forgot, there's no license on it either, so it's out there. You can do with it what you will. I would have let you do with it what you will anyway. So experiment with it and break it, do whatever. Because once upon a time, I was where you are, which is I hadn't written a game, and the only way I learned was basically experimentation and breaking stuff. So I'd like to spend a few minutes thinking about what sorts of games we can develop, because it's food for thought. While we're working through what we're working through today, you can start thinking about what sorts of games are possible. So we start to think about genre. Genre for video games is kind of a nebulous idea. A lot of different people have different ideas about it. I think in a very structured way. So I think about there's shoot 'em ups, which is kind of a staple of video games, and you move a little avatar around and you shoot things and they shoot back at you, and there's bullets flying all over the place. This is one of the earliest known video games. It's called Space War, and it was vector graphics on a vector graphic interface. It's a shoot 'em up. This is a beat 'em up, which is kind of like a shoot 'em up, but it's more constrained. It usually emphasizes kind of rock, paper, scissors gameplay. Is everybody familiar with the concept of rock, paper, scissors? Or is anybody not? Yeah. Rock, paper, scissors comes up all the time in video games. The concept that there is a particular attack or a particular action that can be taken, and there's always a counteraction that can be taken. Good video games always have that balance. The platformer game, which is basically an action game while you're walking around and jumping and swinging and rolling and jetpacking and whatevering around. This is obviously Mario, which is kind of the one that everybody refers back to as an epitome of good platforming design. Puzzle games that are more about contemplation and finding solutions to tricky problems, even Minecraft. Minesweeper. And a lot of games, even though they're not puzzle games, will include puzzles in them. Exploration games that have a world for the player to explore. They might also be given things to do that change the world. And typically, there's puzzles to solve. And then there's action-adventure games, which blend the action genre with the adventure genre. Strategy games that rely on the player's decision-making skills and thinking and planning. They're often about kind of an empire-level struggle against other empires, but they can also be quite abstract, like chess or Go. And they can be slower and more contemplative, like turn-based games, or they can be faster and more reaction-based, like real-time games. And then there's the simulation genre, which focuses more about the mechanisms that make the world tick and gives the player pretty direct control over those mechanisms. And there's an emphasis on attempting to realistically model real situations. There's also vehicle simulations, which is kind of a variant of the action genre as well. There's role-playing games, or RPGs. The player characters in these games grow or are customizable through the game. Often the player can change the world in some way, like the adventure games. And there's also JRPGs, which follow their own specific formulas, although a lot of those are very much just like adventure games with a little bit of character growth thrown in. They're really just exploration games. There's the first-person shooter or first-person simulation game, which is just another way of looking at all the other genres, really. The first FPS games were actually role-playing games, but with more limited freedom than more modern first-person view games like Doom. There's also third-person games, which again are just a different way of looking at all the other genres. This is one of the first first-person games called Akableth, which is from 1980. So roughly speaking, in my worldview, there's six kind of flavors, six kind of genres that you can mix into a video game. And you can mix and match, you can blend them together, but you know, strategy and action and puzzle. These are the kind of the core things that you can build into a game. And it's a good idea when you're starting out to just pick one, to not try to go overboard. Because once you've chosen one of these, we can then start thinking about other little tweaks that you can bring into the game. So this is just a sampler of some little extras that you can throw in to those core genre types. Where are we? I think it's on, yeah, it's on my next slide. So the real-time strategy game, or the auto-scrolling action game that you find on mobile devices a lot. The one-button game, again, very popular with mobile devices, where the only interaction the user has is a tap, and we'll be using that today. Then there's things to avoid. The ice level, where only the player is actually affected by the ice, so the huge disadvantage, which players generally tend to find as quite annoying. The invincible bosses, the goddamn bats. So to explain what the goddamn bats is about, there was, I forget the name of the game now, there was a platforming game where at a certain point in the game, bats would start to appear. The bats could attack the player, but the player couldn't attack the bats, and they were so hard to get past. And so they have spawned this whole thing about the goddamn bats in that game. Grind. I mean, grind is an integral part of so many games that whilst as a human being we tend to kind of get a perverse pleasure out of grind, that's why we go to a day job every day, but as a designer of a game, if you can try to avoid defaulting to grind, which is basically making the player do 10 things in a row just to achieve one small token, if you can avoid that sort of gameplay, then you're doing well. And the micropayments. Yeah, that's a new one. In the original version of this, I didn't have micropayments, but I've added that one in because, anyway. So then you've got, once you've done all of that kind of thinking about what the core aspect of the game is, then you start thinking about what's it going to look like? What's the feel of the game going to be like? So the general flavor. How the game is rendered is part of this, that whole idea of being a 2D side-scroller or a first-person game or a third-person game or a fixed perspective game. And then you can think about the general style of the game that you're aiming for, and again, you know, just a random selection. And you can mix and match these. So the zombie space opera is always popular, the pirate romance. Most importantly, though, going back to that first slide of the six kind of core aspects, certainly I think you'd avoid multiplayer in your first game. You should avoid multiplayer in your first game, but you focus on one of them. So the idea is that when you're starting out writing games, always have a small target. Go for something simple. Don't go for the grand vision. And be ready for that thing to fail. And do that half a dozen times and expect that it probably won't be a very good game, or it might just be a complete mistake and you'll discover that halfway through. And that's fine, because that's what everybody does. Everybody's first game is terrible. Minecraft, huge, huge game. Notch had written many games prior to that, and it just so happens that one game stumbled on a magic formula that people have tried to figure out exactly what it is about Minecraft. There's been research into what it is about Minecraft that has so captured everyone's imagination, and it just happened. So you never know. Shoot for something simple. Focus on that one gameplay and build that. So let's make a game. This is where you're going to want to open your favorite text editor and a terminal. What I'll ask you to do is type in the start of our game. And if you're having trouble reading that, there's a couple of seats up the front here. Yeah, if you're having trouble seeing it, there's two seats up the front here. Oh, you're not going to be able to get around that way, though, unfortunately. So I can just gauge how people are going. When you've finished, just throw up a hand or something. And you should be able to run Kivy game.py. Save that as game.py and then run Kivy game.py, and it should not throw an error. It won't do anything fantastic, but it shouldn't throw an error. Now, if it does throw an error, if it's a syntax error, then double check that everything you've typed is correct. If it doesn't throw a syntax error but throws some other bizarro error, like, random library can't be found or something like that, I'm afraid you're going to have to find a buddy and share, because that's not something we can sort out right now. Yeah. You'll get a blank open window. Yep. It's just the start. So yes, all we're doing here is we're opening our blank slate in which we're going to create the game. And you'll be able to close that window with the escape button, the close button or the escape key. I think we've still got a few people typing. Anyone still going? Yep. Okay, so what's going on here? Well, first thing we'll notice is there's an app, and we're defining a thing called an app. And in Kivy, there's only one app, and it's a subclass of the Kivy app. And as I said, there's only one. And it must define a build method. And the build method must return a widget or a subclass of a widget. So in this case, we've got our game class, which is a subclass of the widget. And that's going to form the core of our game code. The app does a bunch of other stuff, but we'll come back to that later. Something that's interesting that I should mention now is widgets by default are 100 by 100 pixels. Our game widget doesn't actually draw anything, so we don't actually see that represented in the window. We can draw things in the game widget by drawing things to its canvas, and we'll come back to that. And the widget can also handle user input. So the game widget becomes kind of widgets become the core of our actual game code. The app, we can kind of forget about now, and we'll come back to it, but we can kind of forget about the app now. So What we're going to do now is draw some things to the screen. So if we want to just add some drawing commands, we're going to draw using the canvas of that widget. Now, is everybody familiar with what's going up on the screen here with the pluses and the minuses and the green and the red? Is anybody not? Yeah, we're all good with that? Excellent. Sorry, I should have asked that earlier. Okay, so there's a few things going on here. Firstly, we're overriding the initialization of the game widget, the dunder init method, which basically is the method that's fired off when the widget is created, when we're doing our game app build. It's very important that we do that super call to make sure that the underlying widget initialization happens. There's a bunch of important widgety stuff that has to be initialized. So the first thing that we always do after our dunder init that we're writing is we always call the super dunder init. And then we're doing a bunch of canvas stuff. Canvases in Kivy are a series of instructions that are run in the sequence that we define them in our code. So we define a color, which is going to be the drawing color, and then we draw a rectangle. And the rectangle that's drawn uses that color. And that color is then set from then on, and any subsequent canvas actions, even if they're not in this widget, will use that color until it's set to something else. So that's a persistent thing. Any changes that you make in your canvas will be reflected in any subsequent canvas actions, unless you change them back in a number of different ways, by, say, setting the color back to white or something like that. The default color is white. You can try removing, so down the bottom here where we're setting the size of the widget to the window size, if you remove that, just comment it out or something, then you'll see the default widget size, which is the 100 by 100. So instead of seeing a blue screen, which I hope you all see a blue screen, instead of seeing a blue screen, you'll just see a little blue box down in the bottom corner of the screen. Now, just a little mention about window sizes. So because Kivy applications are typically deployed to fixed resolutions, so a mobile device which has one resolution and one resolution only, Most Kivy applications don't bother mucking around with handling changes of window sizes, but you can do that if you want to. If you're developing a desktop application using Kivy, you can have something that reacts to the window size changing. I'm not going to bother with that today because we don't need it for a mobile game. So this is the Kivy coordinate system, which is how we position things on screen. All of the widgets by default are, as I said, 100 pixels by 100 pixels, and they're positioned at 0, 0. So our blue box, which is the size of the window, is positioned at 0, 0, 0 by default. And those coordinates increase in the Y direction, goes up the screen, and the X direction goes across the screen. This is pretty much natural to most, you know, mathematical coordinate systems. The color system is defined as components in red, green, and blue. They're defined as values from 0 to 1, where 0 is dark and 1 is bright. So a color of 1, 0, 0 would be red, bright, and green and blue, dark. Most of the programs that you can use to define colors, though, use values of 0 to 255. So you'll have to scale those down to put them into Kivy. Kivy does have a facility, though, for handling colors in a HTML specification. So the HTML color coding of hash and then three hexadecimal numbers. If you can get your colors in that format, you can ask Kivy to parse them out and generate a color specification that you can pass into the color command. Okay, so the canvas and rectangles and all that sort of stuff, they're fun, but they're not really that interesting. So we're going to remove that now. Oh, actually, we're going to talk a little bit about the Kivy, the KV language. I kind of have to address that because it's part of Kivy. We're just not going to use it. So the KV language was added by the Kivy developers to kind of lessen the tedium of laying out and configuring GUI applications. So what we can do is we can actually remove the color and rectangle stuff from our code here and effectively just put that pass back in. And we can create a file called game.kv, which does effectively the same thing by kind of specifying a style for the game class. Kivy does a few magic things behind the hoods here, under the hood here. So it knows to look for the file game.kv because the app is called game app. And so it takes the game part of game app, lowercases it, puts on a KV and tries to find a file called game.kv. It'll then, inside that file, which is in the Kivy, or the KV syntax, which is similar, I think, to YAML. I think that's YAML. Anyway, it has definitions in it based on the classes in your program. So the game class will have these instructions applied to it. And there's a variety of different instructions you can put in here. You can actually do quite complex coding inside these files, but for developing a game, games tend to be more dynamic, and so we tend to put our code actually in Python code rather than in KV files. But you'll find that if you create this file and you run the program, it'll look exactly the same as it looked before. But you can muck around with the color setting there or the position or whatever and rerun the program, and you'll see that rectangle moves around or changes color or whatever. Yeah, so unfortunately, if you start using the KV files, you'll find that you end up having to litter ID references all throughout the code to be able to access objects from both your Python code and your KV code, and it just becomes a bit of a nightmare. There's a lot of duplication of names, so tend to avoid that. Anyway, so we're gonna ignore the KV pretty much entirely. We will come back to it, though, a little bit later. So what we're going to do now is actually do something slightly more interesting and load some images up and render those instead of our boring rectangle. So Kivy has pretty good support for loading images up in a variety of different formats. By default, it can handle PNGs and JPEGs, and I think Windows bitmaps, which is kind of odd in these modern days, but PNG and JPEG pretty much covers off most of the things we need to do. If you need to load up images in other formats, it's got support for PIL, the Python imaging library, built in. Oh, and a note, you should delete the game.kv file once you've done this step. Otherwise, it'll still be loaded and you'll still get that blue rectangle. Oh, no, that's still there. I'm just, for space, I'm not going to show the entire source code from here on. Yep. Yep. That's actually, who's got the zip? Yeah. Sorry, the USB key's got that there. Is anybody else missing the files yet? Okay, we'll pass that down. Or I'm just going to jump out for a second. It's going to throw out the timer, unfortunately. But this is the screen. Okay, there you go. It's right at the bottom, unfortunately. I'll put it up the top. There you go. So that's the URL for the zip file. And this is the part where we give away the game that we'll be developing today. Okay, so once you've run that, you should see our black window, but with a couple of images drawn in it. How are we going? Okay, so we're seeing some images pop up in the screen now. Yep. Okay, cool. So this is where we start seeing some of the little Kivy oddities. So by default, Kivy's image widget doesn't size itself to the size of the image that comes up off disk. So you'll see that the background is actually really, really small. It's actually supposed to be 380 odd pixels high, but it's being scaled down to 100. So what we've got to do is we've got to fix that. But we'll fix it in a way that means we only have to kind of do it once. So is everybody cool? We can move on? Or are we, got a little bit. Oh, yes. So it should be at the root of that zip file, that zip folder. Sorry, should have mentioned that. Yes, because it needs to access the images directory that's inside that folder. Yeah. Sorry. And then it should be able to load those images up just fine. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll create a subclass of the Kivy image class that resizes itself to the size of the image that's come off disk. And we're going to call it sprite. Sprite is a term that's used all through game development. It's not only used in game development, but it's very common in game development. And sprite is a term that we use to describe an image that has that appears on screen, that an image that has a position and a size. And so it's quite apt to use in this instance. So this is an image that knows where it is on screen and it knows what size it is. And again, because images in Kivy are just a subclass of widget, we have to make sure that we do all of that dunder init super call stuff so that we make sure that the widget is initialized correctly. And so once you run that, hopefully you'll see the background image at a nice reasonable size. Wow, that's a high resolution screen you've got there. Wow. Yeah, that's certainly bigger than it was. What is that? That's a very, yeah. Are you running Kivy 1.8 or 1.9? Yeah. Hmm. How are we all going? All good? Not yet? It's not going to fill up the entire window. We'll do that next. Pardon? The bird. Really? It's exciting. Do you see that as well, do you?
Well, on mine, the bird went way down there instead of flying.
Oh, no. The bird is in exactly where we asked it to be, which is at 0, 0 on the screen.
The wing looks like an eye.
Oh, okay. So, I use PyCharm as my IDE, and so it can hook into, well, any Python program, and certainly it can debug. The setup for 1.9, Kivy 1.9 is a little tricky, but certainly Kivy 1.8, it was perfectly able to run as a debugger and to stop and inspect Kivy programs. Yeah. Yeah. So what we're going to do now is we've got all that window around the game that's kind of all just black, so we're going to get rid of that. So what we'll do is we'll size the window so that it's the size of the game, the size of that background image. So we just have to modify the way that we're loading up the background so that we keep a reference to it so that we can look at it later on. And then we set the size of the widget, the game itself, the game widget, to the size of the background, that background image. And then once we've created that game widget, its size will be the size of the background, and we can set the window size to the size of the game widget. So you should see now that window, which is going to be tiny on your screen. That's weird. I wonder what's going on there. The Kivy 1.9 release had specifically said that it had added stuff to work with retina displays. It's also, which is odd because I've got a retina display here as well, so it's weird. It shouldn't affect what you're doing. We're going to come back to the whole window sizing thing in a little bit anyway. So, this particular game involves the game constantly scrolling across the screen, and the bird flying along, so all the, everything else kind of scrolls past it. So we have to talk about how we do that. If we're all good, just a couple of seconds more. You can always cheat off your neighbor if you need to. So, given a very large play area, which we have in most games, we typically have a very small view into that game. And we call it a viewport. It's a little porthole viewport thing into the game world. And it's positioned in some X and Y position in the game. Fortunately, our scrolling that we have in this particular game is constrained to just scrolling in one direction. And it starts off at one end of the game world. So it simplifies things for us a lot. And also, the landscape that we're scrolling past is constantly repeated, so that simplifies things even further. So given that we have a viewport into the world that looks something like this, kind of just a hole into the world, we can draw our scene into it just fine, but when that scrolls off to the left, when that background scrolls off to the left, we end up with a gap. Everything outside the black is off the screen. We don't care about it. Note that the bird isn't moving, the background is moving. That's an important concept to get across, you know, as starting out writing games. Everything else is moving. So what we'll do is we'll draw two copies of the background. One that scrolls off and the other one scrolls on. And then once the first copy is scrolled all the way off to the side of the screen, we just move it back so that it starts scrolling on itself onto the screen again. To do this, it's not that tricky. We will start off with just moving that image. And to do that, we use the Kivy clock, which will give us a regular tick. It'll give us, in this case, we're asking for a tick every 1/60th of a second, or 60 times per second. We'll get a tick from that clock, which we can use to take some action. And in this case, the action we're taking is we're just moving the X position of the background 2 pixels to the left. To organize our code nicely, we're moving that background image and its behavior, because it has specific behavior, which is that it scrolls off to the left. We're moving that out into its own class. And this is a good way of organizing things. We don't want to lump everything into our game class, because it quickly would become unwieldy and very difficult to add features to, very difficult to maintain. So it's a good idea to think about your game as those kind of discrete bits and pieces that have their own behavior, have their own needs, that can belong in their own classes. Another thing to note is our update method that we're having called by the clock has a star ignore, because we're going to ignore any arguments that are passed in. We'll come back to that later. Yes, self.x minus equals 2. And I just found that that's a good value for the speed that things should scroll past. So if you run that, you should see the background scroll off the screen. Nothing comes in again. We haven't done that bit yet. Yeah, so, yeah, Kivy, during its initialization, is kind of a convenience thing. It has a bunch of different window classes that could be used depending on the environment you're in. And so during import, it figures out which one to use, and then it'll create an instance of it, and that becomes the window with a capital W that comes in when you import it from that module. Yes. There's no reason to ever subclass window in Kivy, so yeah. So, background scrolls off screen. What we need to do now is extend our background implementation so that it has the two images that scroll along. So the update is kind of similar, but instead of just scrolling one thing, it scrolls two things. And that copy of the image is just, that second image that comes in is just a copy of the same image. And so we'll call that image dupe. I could have called it image copy, image two, image whatever. It doesn't really matter. Another thing to note here is that the background has now turned from being an image itself to being a kind of a, just an image container, kind of a virtual thing. There's nothing actually drawn for the background widget itself, but it contains a couple of images that are drawn. But we still do use its dimensions, its size, as the thing that we set the window size to. So do we see two images? The green? Unfortunately, I can't zoom. The green.
It disappears into the white.
I can see if I can. Sorry, the accessibility zoom. I don't think I can do that in Keynote. I could turn off color entirely. So if I black and then so we're going to be relying on just the pluses and the minuses. See if that made any didn't make any. I don't know whether you'd be able to follow along. I could certainly. Unfortunately, not for this particular style because it's a it's a style I defined. So, is that?
Wow.
Yeah. I'm going to do this for this. Yeah. If we can read that, that's all, yeah. Yeah. So I think all up we're writing about 200 lines of code for this thing. Some of these changes are large-ish, some of them are smaller. Yeah, the background widget itself is kind of a virtual thing that just contains a couple of images that are actually rendered, yeah. But it does have that important information about the size. So its size is the size of one of the background images. Yeah. Are we all good?
Mine disappears after it has run once.
Yes, that's what you'll see. Oh, sorry, no, after you've run once. Okay. So just double check you've got in the update method, you've got things spelled correctly in the update method there. Okay, yeah? Oh, so you guys have got the Retina thing going on as well, have you?
Yeah, we got a hack.
Oh, man. How about that? Yeah, that's. Yeah. How about that? You've got the right one. It's crazy. Something weird going on there. Okay, so now that we've got the. So if you're on a Retina screen, then you could set the window size to kind of half the background size, and then it would fit correctly, and you wouldn't see that thing coming in. Okay, so what we'll do now is we'll add in some user interaction. So we'll actually do something with the bird, right? So we've got to define our bird sprite, which is the thing that has the behavior attached to the actual thing the player controls, the avatar that the player has in the game. So instead of it just being a static image on screen, it has an update method that tells it that it should be doing interesting things. And it has an event handler, which handles the interaction of the player with the screen. Those are just things we're inventing for the purposes of this game. Yep. The Kivy widgets don't understand velocity and gravity and so forth. And again, these are just numbers that I ended up with after experimentation and playing and seeing what worked. Gravity, obviously, in real life is not minus 0.3. Pixels per second, or anything crazy like that. But in Kivy, in Flappy Bird land, gravity is minus 3.3 pixels per second. So the update method is going to be called 60 times a second, roughly. We can't guarantee that. Sometimes it'll be called more slowly if the device is having a hard time with things. It won't be called faster than that. But that's okay. If things slow down, it just means the game slows down just a little bit, and that's okay. An important thing that we add in here is a maximum velocity for the bird's direction, for the bird falling. If we let velocity get out of hand in a game, typically it'll cause problems with other parts of our game. Things will go a little bit awry. Collision detection might not work because we're going way too fast. So in this case, it's just a good idea to kind of set that as a maximum of minus 10 pixels per second. And if the user touches the screen, we just reset the velocity to a positive 5.5 pixels per second. And again, that's just a value that came up during playing that turned out to be a good value for having a good challenge in the game.
Excuse me, but did you mention about star ignore?
Star ignore I'll come back to later, yep. Because we'll actually use it. we'll stop ignoring it.
So the second line of your update, is that supposed to be velocity x equals the max?
Velocity y. It's all velocity y. The bird doesn't have velocity in the x direction. It's static in the game, effectively. Everything else is moving past it. And you can see also that the bird, which is an image, we can pass its position in as one of its constructor arguments. So we're setting it to the 20 pixels in from the left-hand side of the screen and half of the screen height, which I now want to know where that actually appears. Did it come up kind of here or down here? Man, that's weird. Yeah, it came up here, which is... Yeah, all right. Yep, good.
Are there limits
to,
like, how far the position can go?
No. It's a floating point number, so it can go really far. So, yeah, so now we've got a bird and we can make it flap, and so that's all good. We're using one style of event handler here, which is on touchdown, which is an event that's handled by that handles either the mouse clicking or the user tapping on the screen. Obviously, if you don't have a touch device, then that's not going to work. So there's a bunch of other event types that we can have handled by our Kivy widgets. There's three that are handled as part of touch, and I'll get to those in a moment. But there's also things like handling keyboard presses, so presses of keys on the keyboard. They're handled a little bit differently, and there's actually some other code that I've given you in that folder that we'll come back to later on, which handles key presses. There's other events which are hardware specific. So there's an on motion event, which is actually the motion sensor that you have in phones. So there's a bunch of other of those event types which are hardware specific. There's, I think there's actually events for handling things like Kinect sensors and things like that as well. So the touch events, we've got on touch down, which we get when obviously the user has clicked or pressed on the screen. If they then move their finger or move the mouse while that button is held down, then we get a move event. And then we get an up event. And this is very common across event systems in many different event systems. Keyboard presses, we also get a key down and a key up. So let's talk a little bit more. So that's events. And that's as easy as events get in this case, because again, we've got a one button game, very simple event, very simple handling. So let's talk a little bit about animation now. Sorry, back to the code. Yep. If you've got a neighbor where it's working, maybe you could cheat off them. How are we going? Missing the brackets around these pause bracket 20 and then bracket pause bracket 20. Yeah. Yep. And then one at the end.
Okay. All right.
There you go.
I knew I was missing something.
Yeah. Scroll down. Self.bird. Did you save?
Well, through the mantle approaching the
have you got line 55? Up. Where's line 55? Can you put line numbers on?
So line 55 is right here.
Yeah, so that's just get rid of that line.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay. So, animation. That's a static bird, not doing very interesting. What we're going to do is animate it in very simple terms. We're going to make it flap when the user touches and make it its wing do something else when it's falling down. So, given that we have an image that has multiple frames of animation in it, which is quite common when we're doing pixel art games, we'll have a single image which has multiple frames of animation in it. We can tell Kivy about those frames by defining the pixel positions of those frames in the image. And we define that in a thing called an atlas. And the atlas is just a JSON file. And you should have it on disk in the images directory. And it, as I say, it just tells it where the images are in that image, where the different frames of animation are in that image. And this is actually really good for optimization. If you can cram all of your images into one file and load that one file up, Kivy can do, and other systems as well, can do some good optimizations based on that. So where we were previously loading our image as the source of images/bird.png, we can actually refer to an atlas and an image inside that atlas using an atlas colon syntax. I'll just change the highlighting here. Hang on. Let me just change that. There we go. I'll do that for all the screens. So yeah, where we were previously loading up just a single image off disk, we're going to load the wing up image out of that atlas and use that. And behind the scenes, Kivy is doing all sorts of caching and image manipulation and so forth to figure out how to get just that one little bit of image for rendering as the bird. And Keynote has decided that the last Atlas reference is actually a URL, and it's highlighted it, so that's good. And yes, so to animate a Kivy image, to change what it's actually showing, all we have to do is change that source parameter. And then Kivy will go and do all of the stuff that needs to be done to have that then be what is drawn on the screen, even if that's a reference to an atlas. Yes, we aren't stopping it from falling off the screen yet. But you're flapping?
Yep.
Excellent. Pardon?
Can you see it?
Oh. Well, let's start again and hang on. No. Nope. Yep. So we start again. Well, no. That cursor goes jumping up there, doesn't it?
What do you want to do?
Like so, well, the cursor has to be over the window so you can kind of flap. Yeah.
Oh, I see. Wait, the cursor will work?
Yeah, there you go. Oh, okay. There you go. Yeah. Yep. So the intention is that it's going to be mouse clicks or trackpad taps or whatever that make it flap. So you have to have the pointer over the window to make that work. The entire, well, under the hood, the entire atlas is loaded up as an OpenGL texture, and then when you ask for a reference like this, it gives you a texture region into that texture, which then means that the other references that are done here, the texture is already loaded, and it's just doing a very, very simple manipulation to move around in that single texture very fast.
So you might load your entire game into one sprite sheet.
Absolutely, and I'll show you an example of that later. The atlas itself, the image is just, it's what I showed on screen, it's just the three birds in one image. Yeah. The .atlas file is a JSON file that defines where those images are inside that. Yeah. Is anybody having trouble? I can help.
We're not flapping.
We're not flapping?
It's just down.
It's just down? Let's see. All right, so if we... click, there you go, and let go. Yep, it's doing it.
Oh, I just can't see what it's doing.
We'll bring it, and.
Oh, yeah, I didn't see that.
Sorry. Yeah, I couldn't see that.
And the wing will go up as it goes down at a certain speed as well. Yeah, yeah. Okay, is anybody having trouble? All right. Oh.
You passed to the next file before I finished update for the background, so I don't know what goes here.
Let's see. So that's just resetting the position of the images. So it's just a self image. Image x equals 0.
Okay.
And then self image dupe dot x self. No. Self image width. Because it's over on the other side. Now you should work. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about scene construction, because what we've got here is a very, very basic scene, and we need to make it a little bit more complex. So scene construction in games is pretty straightforward. You draw something to the screen, and then you draw something else to the screen, and something else, and stuff is just drawn from the back to the front in the order that you draw it. So, we have a background, we have some pipes, we have a ground, and that's drawn over the top, so the layering is starting to come into it. Then we've got the bird in the foreground, and a little secret, we're not being particularly fussy about what stuff is drawn off the screen, we don't care. Kivy doesn't care, your handset doesn't care, nothing cares. It's not going to, if you draw the most humongous image possible, with most of it being off the screen, we don't care, it's not going to be drawn. The rendering engine, even on your phone, will say, I'm drawing these pixels that are on the screen, anything that's off that, I don't care about. It's not going to crash the computer or anything like that, it's just going to be happy. So, we need to start adding more to our scene. So, let's add some ground. So, it's just another sprite. And it's another sprite that has its own behavior as well. So just like the background, it scrolls at 2 pixels per update, 2 pixels per second, scrolling across the screen. A big difference here, though, is that the ground image, I don't know if you noticed, but I'm just going to flip back a screen here. The ground image is slightly larger than the size of the screen. It's actually 24 pixels. Every 24 pixels, it repeats. And so when that image has scrolled off 24 pixels, we just shove it back again, and it just keeps on repeating that way. We could have done the same thing with the background image and just have it twice as large, but that's kind of a waste of memory. There are other techniques we could have used for the background as well, because it's mostly blue. But you know, that's something we'll come to later. going tappy tappy. And of course, you'll notice that the bird still doesn't collide with the ground because we haven't done that bit yet. We'll do that next. Yep.
I'm not sure what it is, but when I click on the image, it crashes.
That's supposed to be an equals, not a minus. I hear lots of tappy-tappy. Not a very challenging game yet. You just have to kind of keep the bird on screen. How are we going? Anybody else stuck? Yeah? There you go. Yeah?
Where, so if I start it, I get one slide of the background, and then I leave it.
Ooh, that's odd. Does the tappy work?
It does.
Yep.
It's so far down now.
Okay, so just bring up your code there, because I can see, yeah, there's clearly the... Yep. So just bring up your code. Go up. It's in the background there. It's actually not scrolling. You're scrolling the widget, not the image. So self image X rather than self X. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about collisions. Are we good? Okay. So collision detection in games. There's, yep. Well, the image itself is repeated every 24 pixels.
Oh, so ground is actually a long thing.
It's a longer thing, yep, and it's repeated, yep. So there's basically four different types of, broadly speaking, four different types of collision detection that you can use in video games. This is by far the most common method, even in 3D games, where basically we draw a box around the things that we want to have interacting, and then we see whether those boxes are overlapping. And if they're overlapping, there's an interaction happening. Very, very simple, and that's what we'll be using today. We can obviously have collision errors here, where the images aren't colliding, but the boxes are. And so this can be seen as slightly suboptimal, and people will try to make things that are more accurate. But generally speaking, in fast-moving games like Flappy Bird or others, the player is unlikely to notice an error like this. They'll just say, yep, I died, move on. A slight variation on this is to actually reduce the size of the box by a couple of pixels, so it's a smaller bounding box. And that can give the player a little bit of leeway that they'll be happier with. And it can often be more fun. And another very common method is using circles instead of boxes, because usually most of the things in games aren't actually square, so we can have a circle that fits them better. And it actually makes the collision detection simpler, because we're just comparing the distance between the midpoints of the two circles, and if it's larger than the two radii, then they're apart. And so that collision that was detected before by the bounding boxes is now not a collision, and that's nice. And obviously, if the circles are overlapping, then we'll say there's a collision. We can miss some collisions, but again, that's kind of okay, because that's kind of in the player's favour, and the player will be happier. So that's nice. And the player probably, again, won't even notice in a fast-moving game. The third type of collision detection is where we use a thing called a hash map. Now, hash maps, as Python programmers, we're familiar with hash maps. We call them dictionaries, and we use them all over the place. Python dictionaries are particularly nice because we can use a bunch of different things as the keys in the dictionaries. So we can use things like the coordinates in a 2D grid as a tuple of x, y, as the key into the hash map. So we take the entire playing area, we divide it up into cells, which are roughly, like in this case, about 10 pixels in size. And then we take the bounding box for each of the things in the game and see which cells those bounding boxes occupy. And we fill them up in the hash map. And then we can say for each thing in the game whether or not that cell is occupied. And if the cell is occupied, then we've probably got a collision. This is particularly useful if you have lots and lots and lots of things in the game. Rather than comparing each thing to each other thing, we're just dumping it all into a hash map once, and then we can do a single lookup for everything to see whether there's a collision. So it's much, much faster. It's also very inaccurate. And typically, you'll end up doing something like this, followed by another check for bounding circles or something like that. The fourth type of collision detection, that's something that people starting out doing writing video games tend to try to aim for, is a thing called pixel-perfect collisions, which is where we're actually comparing each pixel in one image against each pixel in another image. This is obviously incredibly expensive, and generally speaking, it's complete overkill for most video games. There are some games in which this is actually useful, which are games that you can actually it's a pixel-based game, and you can mutate the game itself by altering the pixels that make up the game. So you can actually find that this is a useful technique, but it's in very limited situations. And you would tend to have one of the other methods as an initial broader scale collision detection method, like the hash maps, before you then went down to this pixel-perfect method. So, let's add our first bit of gameplay. Write down the bottom of the game update method. Hang on. Down the bottom of the game update method, let's detect whether the bird is colliding with the ground. And we use a thing called collide widget to do that. And if it is, we'll print game over. Right. So you'll notice, obviously, the bird doesn't stop. It keeps going. But you do get game over printed into the terminal. So that's exciting. We'll come back to making the bird stop in a little bit. But first, we have to add more gameplay, because it's not a very interesting game at the moment. So we need to add the pipes, right? So this is the core part of the gameplay. So adding pipes. We add pipes by setting their left position over to the width of the display. So hopefully they'll appear off the display for most of us. We add them, and this is very central to the gameplay of the game. We add them so that gap between the pipes is 3.5 birds high. This is the flappy bird height. This is the core challenge of the game. Combined with the amount, the velocity that you get when you tap, this is the core part of the gameplay. The pipe ends are positioned at least 50 pixels away from the edge of the screen, so they don't look too munty. And that generally gives us a good variation. And we're going to move the pipes at 2 pixels per update, so they scroll across the screen with everything else. And then when they end up off of the screen, we remove them from the game. So generally speaking, we'll only have about two sets of pipes on the screen at once. Maybe 3, I think. No, 2. New pipes are added every 1.5 seconds. So just jumping back here, we'll be adding the pipes so that they're each set of pipes, each set of top and bottom pipe, is a widget. And the origin of the widget, for convenience in this case, the origin of the widget is going to be just here, this corner of this pipe. So we'll be positioning, we'll be generating a position for the corner of this pipe, and then all the rest of the pipes will be positioned around that. So the top pipe will be 3.5 birds above that, and the bottom pipe will come down. Or the top of the bottom pipe will be that position. So we need some randomness. So right at the top of the file, we're going to import random. I won't edit the color of this one because that's a pretty easy one, hopefully. So we're importing the random module. The next one I'm going to have to change the color for because, yeah. Unfortunately, this is the bit where we add a bit of code because the pipes, we have a bit of stuff to do. So, but we'll work through it. All right, so each of the pipes, it's called pipe here, but it's actually the double pipe, the top and the bottom pipe are represented by one of these widgets. And again, we're just loading in the top image and the bottom image, and we're positioning them based off that, the position of the corner of the top of the bottom pipe, top of the bottom pipe. So there's a bit of mucking around there with, you know, the positioning of things. Don't bother about putting in that comment about the 3.5 birds. That's a reminder to me. Sorry. Yeah, so unfortunately, by the time we finish this bit, you're not going to see anything new on the screen. We still have to add another bit as well. Yeah. So we'll just make sure everyone's got this bit in. And if it doesn't work, I can come around and help you.
Could you talk about where you got these marvelous images from?
So, yeah, it's not too hard to find the source images for Flappy Bird online these days. They're not necessarily the original images from the game, but they're certainly very close to them. And there's plenty of people who... they're pretty easy to draw. So, yeah. So, okay, yeah. So to get the source art for games, I mean, I'm not an artist, I'm a programmer. Although I've picked up a few things about doing art along the way, it's kind of hard not to. There is a lot of source material out on the internet for creating games with. Some of it is not necessarily legal, so there's a bunch of people who've ripped the sprite sheets out of popular video games, but there's an awful lot of Creative Commons licensed or otherwise okay to use licensed material out there that you can use to create games. And in fact, later on you'll see some of it, which was released as in one of the communities on Reddit. Okay, so how are we going? Anybody still typing here? Yep, a couple of people. Okay. The next one is shorter. Just. but I'm pretty sure this is the largest amount of typing. And again, if you get this, if you get an error in this, I can certainly come around and help you without us needing to come back to it. Oh yeah, absolutely. So there's a few convenience methods that you get on widgets. Widgets are always some sort of rectangle, some sort of box. So there's a bunch of convenience attributes that are set on the widgets, write being one of them. You can, it's a set as a property, so you can set it or refer to it. Center is another one. It'll give you the center coordinates, X and Y, of a widget. You can also access center X and center Y. Right and top are derived. There's no bottom and left because that's just X and Y. You can set and get those. So it's quite convenient for positioning. Okay, so now we need, so that's a set of pipes. So now we need a container for all of the pipes in the game, which, as I say, is shorter. Let me just fix the coloring there. There we go. So this is the container that manages our pipes. And it actually, all it does is update them. So it contains the pipe sets as they go across, and it adds new pipe sets when it needs to and figures out the random positioning of those pipe sets in the game. Each widget in Kivy has an attribute called children, which is a list of all the child widgets that it contains. And in this case, the pipes container only contains pipe children. So we can just iterate over that list of children pipes to define them all. So in the previous slide, in the update, there was an update in the previous, let me just, yeah. In the pipe update, when the pipes scroll off the screen, they detect that themselves and remove themselves from the screen. We have to take a copy, so we're using list here to take a copy of that children list because we're going, some of the children might mutate that list while we're iterating over it. So we have to be careful to make sure we take a copy to iterate over. That's why we have a list there. Did that make sense? Oh, good. I'm glad. So the other thing to notice here is that update actually has an argument now, and we're using it. And the argument is called DT, which is a shortening of delta T, or change in time. And it's simply the amount of time that has passed since the last time update was called. And it'll be roughly 1/60th of a second. As I said before, sometimes it might be more. It'll never be less. The clock scheduling we have with Kivy is a guarantee that we won't be called more frequently than 1/60th of a second. And so yes, we figure out the random positioning of the pipe in the Y direction by figuring out where the top of that bottom pipe is. So the random range is from the top of the bottom pipe, which is 50 pixels up from the bottom of the screen. And then the top of the random range is the distance that the top pipe is from the top, which is 50 pixels, plus that gap of 3.5 birds, which is 24 pixels. The bird is 24 pixels high. Now I could simplify that sum in the code here to a single number, but I find it's useful to keep the actual original values in the code as a reminder to myself why I have that particular number. And that particular sum, Python, when it compiles the code, it'll reduce that down to a single number for me anyway. So I don't need to optimize that in any way. So this will add new pipes for us, one every 1.5 seconds. So there's just one more little bit we need to add before we can actually see pipes appear on the screen. And that is, we need to add that pipes container as a new widget to the screen. And it's very important that it goes between the creation of the ground and where the ground is actually added as a widget, so that we get the correct layering of our images on the screen. So the ground is drawn over the top of the pipes, but we can still refer to the height of the ground as part of the pipe positioning. Oh, sorry, the colouring. Yeah, sorry. Yep. Colouring. There we go. The green seemed like such a good idea. So once you've finished this, you should be able to run the code and pipes should start appearing on the screen. If it doesn't work, let me know and I'll come and find out what the problem is. So, pipe, so the no, that doesn't take a DT, but this does. So if you scroll down to game, I'll turn this mic off. Let's make that go away. Great. Okay, so there's really just the one more thing we'll do before we have a break. I'm just going to fix the color for this one. Okay, and that is we're going to collision detect with the pipes. So this is one that's not too hard to do. Right up the top of in our game class init, just underneath where we do the clock schedule, we're going to set a variable called game over, because we now have a bunch of different conditions where we'll detect in game over. And so we'll set game over to false. And then when the bird collides with the ground, we set game over to true. But then we also detect collision with all of the pipes. And if any of those are colliding, we set game over as true as well. Nope. This is a flag that we are then detecting later on to print game over. Yep. Yep. So then you should see game over printed if you collide with the pipe. I guess an important thing to mention here is that this is how games are developed. You add a little bit at a time. You get something working, and then you add a little bit more, and you add a little bit more. Okay, I'm just, is anybody still going on that? Yep, okay, a couple. Yeah, we're just gonna add a couple more things, just two more edits, and then we'll go for a break. We'll get to that point where the game actually stops when it should, and then we'll take a break. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is we need to reward the player a little bit, right? Have a score. So, again, a fairly simple little thing where we're just going to count the number of... Hang on, sorry. Black in the break. I'll set this on all of the other slides. Okay, so we're going to set, so the top edit, that's in the actual pipe itself, in the pipe class itself. At the end of the initialization for the pipe class itself, we're setting a scored variable, a scored sentinel, to false. This ensures that we only score each pipe once. Then in the game class itself, where we're defining the game over, just next to that, we're defining a score and we're setting that to zero. And then down in our pipe detection loop, where we're checking for collisions with the pipe, we also check to see whether the right-hand side of the pipe has passed the left-hand side of the bird, which is the X position of the bird. And if that's true, then the player scores that pipe. And so we set the scored value on the pipe to true, and we increment the score for the player. And we set that scored thing because once the pipe has passed the player, it's still on the screen past the player. And so that score would just go up each tick if we didn't say it had already been scored. And that's, again, that's one of those things that I noticed when I was developing this, is that I threw in all this code without the scored check, and the score just went ping, and I was like, hey, I'm so cool, wait. And I added this little flag here. It's that iterative process. So now, obviously, we're still at the stage where you can be cheating cheaters and keep playing and get an awesome score after you've got game over. But you wouldn't do that, right? You're not those kinds of people. Yeah. Is that working for everyone? Nope. You've got a D on your scored rather than just score. So that should be score rather than scored. There you go. Yep. Okay, so at this point, we're actually going to bring Kivy, the KV file, back into things because something I mentioned earlier on, it's actually really good for defining the style of things. And we're going to have a few text labels in our game. And we actually want them all to have the same style, which is the same font and the same font size and the same font color. We don't have to repeat ourselves each time we create a new label in the game. So we're going to use the KV file here, which is game.kv, and we're going to just set the style for all of the labels in the game in one spot. So it's actually quite handy for that. The file name is kind of random, but it's actually the Flappy Bird font, but it's not called the Flappy Bird font, it's called 04B_19. That's its actual name. I don't know what it could possibly mean. But it's a true type font, and Kivy can render any true type fonts. It's, you know, you can just sub in any true type font that you happen to like, and there's stacks of free true type fonts out there. There's bound to be one that suits your particular game. Okay, so once we've got that typed in, and again, unfortunately, this is one of the things where we won't know whether we've typed it correctly until we've done the next step, but it's not too big an edit. Once everyone's got that copied in, we will actually use it as a label in the game to display the score properly. Just give me a second here. Okay. So we're actually using one of the user interface elements for Kivy now. We're using a label. It's very exciting. And here we're using one of those convenience methods I was mentioning before that we get off of the Kivy widgets. Because the label is just another Kivy widget where we can set the center X to the center X of the current widget and the top to the top. Minus 30, but yeah. And very much like the images, when we want to change the text that's being displayed by a label, we just change the text attribute to some other string, and that will render itself as the text in the label. So with that change, you should see the score appear up on the screen as you go. So how are we going? What do you need? I was just going to say, it can actually be useful to explicitly have a cheating cheater mode like this, where you disable something like the game over check, so that you can make sure that your ongoing gameplay actually works. So, you know, there's benefit to this. By the way, you've got your ground position in the wrong order there. Sorry. Just to remind everyone, the way that it knows to use game.kv is because the app class that we've created for the app is called game app. So it takes the app part off and looks up a file with that name. It's really hacky, but it works. So another question was just asked is, the label that's defined in the KV file, in the angle brackets, that refers to the class that's found in our Python code. So in this case, it's the label that's been imported, but you can subclass that. Even if it's just a pass, an empty subclass, you can subclass that and have a different style in your KV file using that new class name. So you can have a variety of styles using the different subclasses. Okay, so the last thing we'll do before the break. Diana, are you cool? Yep, okay. So the last thing we'll do before the break is we'll stop the game when the game should be stopped, when it's game over. This is actually pretty easy to do. In essence, all we're doing is we're saying, game update, don't update anymore, right at the top. But we're also going to bring in another label to say game over, which is actually really simple to do. The game over label is actually going to be the whole time. It's just fully transparent, so we can't see it. So the opacity, which is the transparency, is set to 0. When we set it to 1, it's opaque and we can see it. So instead of printing game over and your score is, we say self over label, set the opacity to 1, and that makes that label appear. And then at the top of the update method, if game over is set, we just don't do the update and the game stops. And that's Flappy Bird. And now we will take a 10-minute break. Okay, so we've implemented the game. That's the core gameplay, right? And that didn't take very long for people who hadn't written a game before. Sorry? Well, you have the power to make the game as easy as you want to. So what we're going to do now is we're going to add some sound effects. Now, we're going to add sound effects. This is a pixel art game, so we should stay true to the roots of pixel art and use some good 8-bit sound effects. And what we're going to do is we're going to use a program called, well, it's called CFXer, but it's based on a game called SFXer, which basically was written a number of years ago for one of the game 48-hour game challenges to generate 8-bit sound effects using basically the parameters you see, or you can kind of blurrily see on the screen here. Those parameters are the parameters that are built into the SID chip of the Commodore 64, the sound interface device chip of the Commodore 64. So we're emulating a Commodore 64. So I'm just going to fire it up. Yeah, I can't type though. Okay, we have sound. Let me just pop that over there. So this is CFXer. And it's got some convenience buttons here for common things you have in games. So flip the player picking up something or getting a coin. And it just generates a random sound effect each time you press the button. And you can see them coming up on the side here. So it remembers each time it generates a sound, and you can come back to it. So, shooting. Explosion. Oh, that's a good one. Power up. Getting hit. Jumping. There was that little Mario one in there. And so on. Completely random. And you can play around with the properties of these effects. So you can say, play it whenever I change it, so I can change the start frequency. Let's get a more fun, hang on. Okay. And so there's all these parameters, and you can play with them and fiddle, but generally I just hit the random buttons. So yeah, CFXer, really easy to quickly generate sound effects. And when you hit the export button, it says export as a WAV file, and you can play WAV files directly from Kivy. You can play WAV files from anything. So, that's how you make sound effects. How do you play sound effects? Where's my mouse gone? Right, hang on. Wait, what? Oh. Just changing color. Sorry. Somebody has found it. There's a web version as well, so you can actually do it like through the web. Which is kind of neat. Okay, so to play sounds, we load them. We use Kivy Sound Loader to load the sound files, and you can see we're just loading the WAV files directly, and we're going to load 3 of them, and we're going to set them as global variables because we're game developers and we use global variables. That's actually really bad practice, but in this case, it's a resource, which is fine. Lots of copy and paste here, so this one shouldn't take too long. Okay, has everybody got the sound effects loaded? Anyone's? Yeah, we're all still typey. Well, do you know how to play them? Yeah. No, not playing yet. SFX die. How are we going? Anyone still going? Yep. It's pretty much copy and paste here. So if you do get left behind a little bit, that's okay. You know what you're copying and pasting. So we'll just move on to the next one so we can get them starting to play. So what we're going to do is those objects, they have a play method, and we can just call dot play, and that will play the sound effect. So in the bird, where we're doing the touch event, we're going to have SFX flap play. In the game, where we're saying we've scored, we're going to play the score play. And in the game where we detect game over, we'll play SFX die. Not the first if game over, the second one. Because if you played it the first one, it'll just constantly play every update. Oh, sorry, ignore the self-texture thing. That'll come later. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, and that comes, yeah. We'll hopefully get to that. We'll say, hey! Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah. It's just at the end of that method, just add that call. That's happy sounds. Wait, there's no dying. What's going on? Who is that? That's what we... Yeah. One of the things you'll notice about this, there's a thing called juice, and hopefully I'll have time to introduce you to some juice. There's a concept about game juice, and the idea is that when players are playing a game, they're kind of as they're getting their hands into the game, they're squeezing, the juice should drip out of the game. Like, the game should have character, and it should have stuff happening in response to the player doing stuff. Sound effects is one of the easiest ways of adding juice to a game, because seriously, it's load the file, play the file. It doesn't get much easier than that. And it just adds something extra to the game. It really does. So one of the things you may notice, though, is if you're flapping a lot, the poor old sound effect doesn't flap a lot. Unfortunately, Kivy's sound engine has a limitation that each sound that's loaded can only be played once at a time. You can play multiple sound effects at once, but each sound effect can only be played once at a time. It has to finish playing, and then you can play it again. Yeah. Like this. Yes. This is unfortunately... Now, you don't have to put this one in, because there's a bit of typing, and we kind of have to move on. But this is how you work around that. You load the sound effect multiple times. This is kind of unique to Kivy. Other game engines don't necessarily have this problem. They can quite happily play a sound effect multiple times and mix them. But Kivy... If you want to play a sound effect multiple times, you have to load it multiple times. And this will just load it up a number of copies and cycle through them as you ask to play them. Again, you don't have to type this. We've got other things we're going to move on to. So we'll come back to that if you're interested, and we've got time at the end. So game architecture. These are some of the higher level things. That now we have the game. The game works, right? But it's not a complete game. You know, you can only play it once, then you have to quit the app and start it again. So there's a few things that go on around the outside of a game. Most games have a concept of at least having another go, you know, having lives. The idea of being able to come back from that game over screen and retry the game. Some sort of splash screen. Options, menus, perhaps. These are all things that kind of exist around the game that add extra stuff, value to the user, the player of the game. So one of the things we are going to add is that kind of that front menu to allow us to restart the game. Bear with me with the color here. So there's a little bit of typey-typey here, but there's a little bit of cut and pasty as well. Because we're basically reusing stuff we've already done. All right. So here we're going to create a new widget, which we're going to call our menu widget. And it's basically got the background image, and it's got the ground image, and it's got a label that says tap to start. And it's got a single event handler. When you fire that event handler, it says to the parent widget, its parent widget, which is the top level widget of the game, says to the top level widget, remove me and add the game itself to the top level of the widget tree. So it's subbing the menu out and bringing the game in. And this is how we're doing kind of scene management in our game in Kivy. Most games have scenes like this, where we have multiple scenes that we're transitioning between. If this was a desktop game, that menu might have quit as well. So it would have start and quit. But since this is going to be a mobile game, we don't need quit, because the player's already got a way of doing quit that they're quite familiar with. Now, after you've added this, it's not going to do anything because we're not using it yet. That's the next edit, which unfortunately didn't fit on this slide, only just. How are we going? So you've got the menu entered? Yep, but it doesn't come up yet. Yep. Okay, we've still got a few people typing. How are we going? Still got a few people typing. Yep. So as I said, there's a bit of cut and paste going on here. A little bit here, but there'll be more. So once we've got this in, then we need to actually bring this up as the top level widget in our app rather than the game. So in the game, where previously we were constructing the game widget and setting that and returning that as the widget, the top level widget from the game app, we're actually going to construct a generic widget. It's an anonymous top-level widget that's going to its children, or it's actually only going to have one child, but that child itself is going to have children. That top-level widget, it's going to hold the scene that's actually the active scene in the game, and we can sub in and out that widget that is the scene. So now if you run the game now, you will see the front menu, and when you tap it, you'll get the game. If it doesn't work, let me know, and I'll come around and help. Yep.
Yeah, it says index out of range, that was index 0.
Okay, let's have a look. Okay, so you're missing the top add widget menu.
Oh,
yep. Everyone else? Anyone else got problems with that? Nope. Yep.
I kind of changed it for a little bit. I'm thinking maybe I didn't do the right thing, but I just unscheduled the update on the mobile. Is that a good idea or a bad idea?
It doesn't really matter. It really doesn't matter. Yep.
I don't like my keep going.
Yeah, but it's only doing it. You know, 60 times a second, which isn't really that much. Yeah.
I didn't get the on-touch move typed in.
You'll get it in a second because there's a very similar version of it coming up. So what we need to do, though, is we need to do something when we hit the game over so the user can reset the game. So now, this is on the game class. We have a touch handler on the game class, which we don't bind to start off with. You can see that I've named it underscore on touchdown. So Kivy won't recognize that as a valid event handler because it doesn't have the proper name. But when we hit the game over state, we can bind that to the on touchdown event. And so when the user taps the screen at game over, we can remove the game from the top level widget and add the menu back into the top level widget. So if you missed the bit where we were adding the doing the same thing for the menu where we're adding the game, it's exactly the same bit of code. It's just that we were using game at the end instead of menu down here. So the menu had the same code, just with game instead of menu. Oh, and also it didn't have the underscore because it was an actual event handler. Is that at all clear? So I have the underscore there so that that's not active while the game is being played, because otherwise they would be tapping the screen and it would quit the game. Yeah. Right. So this then gives us that complete game architecture effect. This is pretty much, if you bought Flappy Bird, the original, off the an app store, this is what you get. This is the complete game. Yep.
So, what were you saying? Like you're using the what is self.bind again?
Okay, so let's So I kind of glossed over that. Self.bind is a way of saying to the widget. So this, in this case, it's the game widget. It's a way of saying, I would like to bind some callback, in this case, the onTouchdown. I would like to bind that to handle the event called onTouchdown. You can bind that to any of the event handlers, so onMotion or onTouchMove or any of those. The window has a bunch of event handlers as well. So if you wanted to handle keyboard presses, you actually bind them to the window. You say window.bind onKeyDown and give it some call. Something to call, and you would get keyboard presses. Are we all good? Anyone got problems with that? Okay, so as I said, that you've now got the complete game that was Flappy Bird that was sold to millions of people. So what we can do from here is we can start thinking about where we might take that. So further considerations. Obviously, this game isn't deployable to a phone yet. We can do that in a second. We can also start to think about how to maybe mix the game up, because seriously, Flappy Bird, that's it. You can get up to a score of 1 million and it's just the same pipes coming in. Variations on Flappy Bird available on various of the stores change that up to quite extreme levels. But we have to worry about first, I think, getting it onto a mobile device. And so that's what we're going to do next. I've got here just a quick video. This is a rip-off version of Flappy Bird called Impossible Flappy. It's going to be blurry because it was taken by somebody else's phone, of somebody playing it on a phone. But it'll give you some idea of where you could take the gameplay. And kind of just the ridiculousness of somebody playing it for this long to get this good at the game. It gets better. Who even do that? So when it gets up to 999, that's kind of when it starts getting interesting. So here we go. That's all very boring. Oh, it cut off! Oh, because at this point, there's a serious rage quit. The phone is thrown on the floor. Oh, man, it cut off. Oh, that's so sad. Okay, anyway. Right. So, Android. Let's try and get this thing. Who actually has an Android device? Yep, okay, cool. Let's see if we can get this thing running on an Android device. So the first thing you have to do is make developer options available. So if you haven't done this, then you have to go into your phone, into the About Phone screen in the settings, it's right down the bottom, and then you have to tap the build number 7 times. And you, after the 7th tap, you'll get a little thing coming up saying developer options enabled. Okay? It's one of those little things. You're going to have Buildozer to make this bit work. So if you haven't got Buildozer, then unfortunately, yeah. You have to have a Mac and you have to have bought a developer key. The one nice thing about Android is it's $20 to put an app up on the store. It's $100 a year to put something up into the Apple Store. So as a, you know, somebody who's just a hobbyist, I'm going to do option A. I have a game up in the Android store. It's been up there for like a year and a half or something now, and it's got like, you know, several thousand installs, which is, you know, all right. And it's an okay game, and it was developed in Kivy. So everyone who's done that. So if you now plug your phone in to your computer, again, if you haven't got Buildozer installed, unfortunately, there's not much point in doing this bit, and I'll kind of walk through it on my laptop here. It's just, yeah. I can help people out with Buildozer afterwards, a little bit. But, yeah, I will walk through this. So let me jump out into a terminal. Okay, so there's a terminal. And I'm plugging my phone in. If you can try and find a buddy maybe who's got Buildozer installed. Okay, so once you've plugged your phone in, you need to go into your settings and go down to the developer options. Okay, it's the second from the bottom in settings now. And then turn developer options on. You turn USB debugging on, which is the third or fourth option down. Another good thing to do is to turn stay awake on. It just means you don't have to constantly unlock your phone while you're working like this. Okay, so now, if you've got Buildozer installed correctly, whoop, wrong thing, oh, I hate doing this bit, you should be able to say ADB devices, and it should have you should have a device appear. Now, it may be that the device comes up as unauthorized. If that happens, then your phone should have a dialogue on it saying, do you authorize this connection? And you should say yes.
You ran through that a little
fast.
Do that again.
So you've plugged the phone into the computer, yep, and you've gone into settings, developer options, yep, you've turned them on, and there's a toggle right at the top. And then down a bit further, there'll be USB debugging. You should turn that on. And stay awake, turn that on. Stay awake is right up the top. Yep, okay. So now if you go to your terminal, if you've configured it correctly with the instructions from the email that I sent out, then ADB should be in your path and you should be able to say ADB devices. Now, who's been able to do that? Just to get an idea. Yeah, 1, 2. Awesome. All right, I'll walk through it here. Just if you haven't managed to get it going, so you can see what kind of what it works like. So ADB devices will give you that list of attached devices. If it comes up as unauthorized, you should get a prompt on your phone saying, do you authorize the connection? You say yes, and then it should come up as device in ADB devices. If that doesn't happen, then there's been a key exchange error and I can maybe help you out. That becomes kind of tricky. So, jumping back, Buildozer. Installing Buildozer, I'm going to skip over that because there was instructions for doing that. The important step is at the end of Buildozer install is you run Buildozer init in the directory that you're developing the game. If you run Buildozer init, it will create a file called buildozer.spec. just double check that the people who have got Buildozer installed see that. Yep. Now the spec file, well, hang on. The spec file looks kind of like, oh, it's reversed. Yes, you run the build. Oh, so the instructions I sent out, running Buildozer in Knit, in those instructions were just to make sure it was all prepared. That's all that was. Yeah. This is to actually use it for reals in anger. So what you end up with is a file that looks like this. It's an ini style file. Oh, hang on. And it just has a bunch of stuff in it. The important things we need to change are this line that says include exts. We need to add TTF and WAV to that line. Yep. So we include our font and our sound effects. Okay. All the standard Kivy stuff is already included, but we need to add TTF and WAV. We also need to change down here, we need to change the orientation from landscape to portrait. And this then defines the orientation that the application will launch in, which is the correct portrait orientation. You can change that dynamically, but that's a whole separate ball game. I'm not going to cover that today. You need to change the... window. Okay, so the first one is this include X line here. Yep. In fact, what am I doing? I don't know what I'm doing. The two edits are these. So you add TTF and WAV files to the source include X, and you add you change orientation to portrait. Okay, so once you've done that, don't run Buildozer Android update, because that's the thing that downloads 2 gigabytes of Android. We've done this. Oh, this is what you see if your device is initially unauthorized. You'll see unauthorized, and then once you authorize it on your handset, you'll see device. Yeah.
Where is ADB coming from?
ADB is part of the Buildozer install, which you needed to make you needed to do the changes in your in your bash profile. Yeah, this is part of the installation. So after all that, after you've set your Buildozer spec file up, you should be able to say Buildozer Android debug, which builds a debug version of the application, deploy run. You can do that all in one command line, and you should see output very much like this. And it goes through a bunch of different steps. So this stuff up here is about making sure that the Android SDK and NDK are all installed correctly. We then build the platform, which is Python and Kivy and any other extras that you've set as requirements, like PIL. You can then builds your application, so gathers together all the bits and pieces of your application, all the source files and the extra files, packages them up, builds them into an APK, which is the Android package file format, and deploys to your device. If you've only got one device connected, it'll deploy to that device. All things going well, you should see the game appear on your device. I'm going to do that now. Cross my fingers. Sorry. ADB, Android. If you were doing iOS, it would be ADB, iOS. Debug, deploy, run. What did I do? ADB, Android. Buildozer. Sorry, thank you. Oh, I haven't activated. Stop the beeping. Right, away we go. So we're building. I know the people at the back won't be able to see this, I'm sorry. Oh, actually. What's it called? Photo booth. This is hilarious. Okay. Here we go. So there's... Oh, that's... oh, this is cheating. This isn't what it's going to look like on your devices. This is a slightly better version of the application, unfortunately. What you would see is right down in the bottom corner, you would see tiny, tiny application. Has anybody actually managed to get that going? You know, this was always going to be the hard bit. I'll show you what it looks like on the device. I don't need that anymore. I'll show you what it looks like on the device when you deploy the current version of what you've just been developing. It looks like that. So you can see the resolution of modern mobile phones is ludicrous. This is a two-year-old phone. Modern phones have almost double the resolution of what I have, so it would be even smaller. Interestingly though, the label correctly scaled. We specified the label size as 40. By default, Kivy says, oh, that's 40 scaled pixels, which are scaled according to the screen size, or the screen DPI, but also scaled according to the user's font preference. So if they want larger fonts, they'll see that larger. So that's scaled correctly, but the game itself is teeny tiny, right? It's crazy small. So we need to scale that up. So how do we do that? Well, at the moment, we're setting the window size to the size of the background, which clearly isn't going to cut it in mobile devices, right? So that's not going to do it, because our window sizes on Android are any number of different resolutions. And it used to be that iOS users could be pretty, you know, smug, but these days they're all over the place as well. So it's a general thing. Mobile devices, you have to handle random resolutions in your game. And even if you ask for portrait, you might still get a landscape display. So you kind of have to handle that stuff. So we're not going to get, I'm not going to get you all to edit this because there's really no point because you can't try it out. But changes we have to make are actually not that difficult. The first thing, obviously, is remove that window size setting because it doesn't make any difference on a mobile device. You only get one window size. If you do that in your version, you'll see the window size is up to, you know, this size here. Actually, and it might be worthwhile you changing that. So if you just want to remove that window size line, you can actually try something out. And that will stop the window being anchored to that particular, the size of the background. But what we can do is, on the Kivy command line, we can actually ask Kivy to give us a window of a different size. So we can say, actually, give us a 1280 by 800 window. Or if you want to emulate my phone, a Nexus 5, then you can actually set all of the display parameters that Kivy would have for that device. So it has a DPI of 480 pixels per inch. It's insane. Your desktop has 96. 480 DPI. The density is a number that Kivy gives to kind of simplify DPI. So really high density screens are given a density of 3. And the size of this display is a ludicrous 1080 pixels wide by 1920 pixels high. My uber fancy Dell monitor at home has a resolution only slightly higher than that, and it's this big. I think there might be, but this is more convenient, I think. Oh, right, sorry. It might just be Kivy size, I don't know. Yeah, so this is how you can try out different resolutions and different DPIs. The thing is though, oh, sorry, I'm just gonna talk about, so density is an interesting thing, and for general Kivy applications, it's actually useful. We can abstract away all these DPI and size issues with correct floating widget positioning, and we can use the DP scaling to scale the size of the things that we put on the screen so that they seem right for different densities and so forth. So that's fine for kind of like a GUI application. And there's even, as I said, there's this scaled pixel thing as well, which is, or scale independent pixel, which is based on DP, but it also takes into account the user font sizing preference as well. So it can vary a little bit. And so, for example, on my device, 1SP is 3.6 pixels rather than 3 pixels, which is the DP value, because the font is slightly larger. But for our game, we don't care about all that. That's too hard to try and make work with pixel art. So what we're going to do is try to just scale our pixel art so that it fits as nicely as possible into the play area. So first of all, we try scaling it widthways. So we say, how do we have to scale it to fit the pixel art across the screen? And we find a scale of 2. And for the height, to fit it to the height of the screen, we have to use a scale of 3. Obviously, though, we lose some of our game off the screen, so that's not acceptable. So we use the minimum of those two values, the minimum of those two scale values. So you don't need to copy this in because, again, there's not really much point. You won't be able to see it in action. This is kind of at the end. I'm going to jump to the end of this. Okay, so, sorry, jumping right to the end of this particular bit of edit. Is that even vaguely visible? No. Okay, I'm gonna just... I'm just going to make a few changes here because they're all very similar. Okay, so... All right. So what we have, what I do is, in generally in these sort of things, is I have a global thing that I call parameters, like, or you could call it options or whatever. And it's just a global variable. It's a class that's instantiated once and set as a global variable inside your game. And its job is to hold configuration for the game. So the first thing that we're adding here is just the scale factor. So we figure out the width and the height, that's the width of the image and the height of the image for the background, and we figure out what the scale factor should be for the game. And then that's available as a global variable that I can use all throughout the game. And then when I load my sprite images, I just scale all of them automatically by that scale factor, because that's a global variable. So the bird and the pipes and the background, everything is just scaled automatically by that scale factor. We do have to add in that allow stretch equals true. Otherwise, Kivy won't allow you to scale things up. I don't know why. We do, however, have to go through every other place where we have a pixel value in our game and multiply it by the scale. Again, it's not that hard to do. We just have to find all of the numbers and add times scale. So the gravity is times scale. The velocity, times scale. All of that stuff, all the positioning, sorry about the color here, but the speeds across the screen, that 2 pixels across the screen is now 2 pixels times the scale. And we do that in all the places where there's pixels. Oh, and then when we're building our game, we initialize our parameters. The first thing we do when we build the game, we initialize our parameters because we've got a window and we can figure out what the scale factor should be. Then, when we run our game, regardless of the size of the window, the game will fit into that window more nicely. We'll still, unfortunately, have a bit of the game exposed that shouldn't be exposed, because generally speaking, it's not going to fit perfectly. So if it's in a landscape window like this, we'll have a bit hanging out. If it's a portrait thing, we'll have a bit hanging out the top. So what we can do is just draw a single black rectangle. As the last thing we draw a single black rectangle over the top of that, and we hide that. And that's, if you wanted to do it slightly more nicely, you could position the game in the center and draw 2 black rectangles, you know, letterbox it. But, you know, this is perfectly acceptable as well. And this is a bit of code to do that. One of the issues that we run into in Kivy, because it's built on top of OpenGL, when it blows images up, does it kind of fuzzily, because most of the images that it's blowing up are fuzzy images. They're like textures, you know, nice textures that need to be scaled up nicely. We've got pixel art, though. We want it to be sharp. We want it to be clear. So we don't want the fuzzy scaling. We want the clear scaling. And in OpenGL terms, that's called nearest. When we're up, when we're magnifying, we want to use a nearest filter instead of what's on the left here, which is a linear filter, linearly interpolating between between the pixels in the art. And so, again, modifying for all of our sprites, we set the magnification filter to nearest for all of the sprites that we load. Unfortunately, the sprite, the atlas that Kivy has no ability to have this set. So I actually had to create a subclass of atlas, which you, I think, should actually be in the Kivy files you've got there in the Kivy fix. I've got a bug report into Kivy about this, but they're not sure how to fix it. But the result of doing all that is that the pixel art will be scaled up nicely and it'll be sharp. Other things about scaling graphics. So this is using pixel art, but you may create your game using SVG art. So using a program like Inkscape. I certainly find it easier to draw in Inkscape than I do to draw pixel art. So the game that I have in the actual App Store uses SVG art. And it's actually pretty easy to write up a little script that just generates, that takes that SVG and generates it as art at multiple scales so that you can have your game scaled up. It's just a case of scripting. Kivy 1.9 can actually render SVG directly, but it does it not as well as Inkscape. Inkscape has very nice rendering of SVG with anti-aliasing. Kivy does not. So you, generally speaking, you want to have Inkscape render it. And even on a Mac, this is, you know, a bunch of code, obviously, but it's pretty straightforward. We're just invoking Inkscape saying, please render the SVG file as a PNG. And we're saving that up, and we're saving that off as multiple width icons, you know, 24 pixels, 36 pixels, up to 128 pixels wide, the different PNGs. And then the Kivy Atlas module can actually turn all of those images into a single Atlas sheet and generate the Atlas file as well, so that I can then load that single image up and refer to the PNGs inside that Atlas, which is kind of nice. There's some other stuff down the bottom there about the cover art for the application as well that I won't go into, but I can generate that as well at the same time. So this is what the sprite sheet looks like that Kivy generates for me, the atlas. So the big images are obviously jammed in at the top all the way down to the little images. And then in my game, I figure out, well, my game is these icons, a grid of 8x8, and I figure out which icon size I should use to fit my 8x8 grid on the screen using just a loop. You know, I go through all the sizes until they don't fit, and then I say, right, well, the last one I found, that's my icon size, and that's what I'll load up to render the game with. The other artwork in the game is based off the DPI. So these icons here, so these are the play icons. These are other icons that are generally mixed in with text. So they kind of want to scale with the text rather than be scaled perfectly to the screen size. So we want them to scale with the SP size or the DPI of the screen. Fortunately, you can find tons of icon sets out there which have pre-baked PNGs at all the different DPIs. The DPIs have a name. So the lowest DPI is called LDPI. And then MDPI, HDPI, and then XHDPI for the ridiculous. And these are free icon sets. And so you just chuck them into your project, and away you go. And you choose the graphic based on whatever Kivy says the DPI is. And it will scale with, you know, the text in your game. And you end up with this result, which is the artwork for the game is scaled nicely to fit the display. And the icon down the bottom here, this icon is scaled with the text. So it's, you know, other issues that might come into play with scaling. I want to talk a little bit more about the application lifecycle for Kivy. So at the top level of Kivy, we have that app. At the moment, all we've got there is a build. It's also nice to, say, have something to save off the score, to record the highest score the player's got. Kivy provides us with a bunch of hooks that we can use to fire off at various times during the lifecycle of the application. Build config is set up if you want to use the default. Kivy has a settings panel that you can use. You generally wouldn't want to use that for a game because it's not styled for the game. But you can use that. If you use that, you can just set up a very simple config structure in build config. And then when the user opens the settings panel, they'll get that. And you can modify the config. If the user changes that config during the time the application is running, you'll get an on-config change event that you can respond to do stuff. Older Android phones had a settings button you could press and it would bring up the settings panel, so it was independent of your application. So this would be how you'd know that that's happened. Also, after build has happened, Kivy will call an onStart or an before it starts actually running your application, so you can load things like your saved on high scores. While it's running, you can get on pause and on resume, which is basically what happens when the application is swapped out and another application is running. So it's a good idea to save the game state in on pause, just in case you never come back. Because when the application is killed, it may or may not get on stop. If at any time you want to stop the application, you can call app.stop, and then once the application is stopping, you get an on-stop call, even if you called stop. And so you can do some cleanup or whatever there, save the state. And if you want to know where to save the state, there's a simple way of determining that. On Android, it's $Android app path, which is set by Android itself. On OS X, it's under that. On Unix, it's under that or that. WinXP, if you're roaming or not roaming on WinXP, and Windows 7 is slightly different if you're roaming or not roaming. So, yeah. There's this great module on the cheese shop called apt-dirs, which does all of that for you. You say, apt-dirs, give me where the config files should be stored for a user. And it'll give you a path, and you save it there, and it's all good. On Android, you still have to look at Android app path because it doesn't know about Android, but hey. And another note about save files, just use JSON. You know, generate your save data as a Python structure with dictionaries and lists and just JSON it. Users could go in and edit it and cheat, but cheaters are going to cheat anyway, so make it easier on yourself. You can go in and have a look at what that save file's got in it. You can edit it. You can do what you need to do while you're debugging. It just makes your life so much easier. I've kind of run out of time, but I've got a little bit more that I could talk about here if you're interested. Yeah? All right. So this, I've mentioned in passing this concept of juiciness, right? This concept that you can just add little things to games to make them feel more alive to players. So sound effects are one of the really simple ones, really easy to add. Sound effects are easy to generate. If you can't generate them, you can generally find them. There's sound effect libraries out there on the interwebs. You can find them, you can play them. Music also helps. It's just another sound effect that just keeps playing. So music and sound effects, really easy juice. Other juice that you can add, colors, simple animations. We've got those in our Flappy Bird. So when we had a static bird that wasn't nearly as alive, we added that little bit of animation, and it just made that bird feel that little bit more alive. Tweening, which I'll come back to. Yeah? Yeah. So tweening, fading things in and out, so fading scenes in and out just to give that little bit of anticipation. Particles, every game is made better with particles. I'll talk a little bit about tweening. So is anybody familiar with the concept of tweening? No. Good. Okay, so tweening is a term that comes out of animation. And it's short for in-betweening. And it's the way of going from a keyframe to another keyframe. It's going from one state to another state in animation, but going smoothly. Rather than just going in a straight line, we go in a bit of a curve, or we go in a bit of a bounce. So tweening is generally encapsulated by these sorts of curves. So instead of just going in a straight line between point A and point B, we'll accelerate or we'll decelerate into that place or we'll bounce. And you can do this with any number of properties in a game. You can do this with position, which is the obvious one, but you can do it with colors, and you can do it with sizes, you can do it with angles. Any property that has a number attached to it can be tweened, can be animated. Tweening is actually pretty simple to code as well. So it's reduced down to a value that transitions between 0 and 1. The 0 might be at time A and 1 at time B, which is 10 seconds later, but we reduced that down to a 0 and a 1. So we're scaling from 0 to 1. And then the value that we're going to set on the thing that we're tweening, so the position or whatever, is moved from the start value to the start value plus that some function operating on that 0 to 1 value times the end value minus the start value, so the difference between the two. So we're slowly scaling, or we're scaling that difference up between those values and adding it onto the start value over time. If we just had a function which returned t, we would get a linear transition, a linear tween between the start and the end. Quad is one of the simplest. Quad gives us a nice, smooth acceleration. Ease in quad begins slowly and then accelerates up to the end point. Ease out quad starts quickly and then decelerates into the end point. So those are by far the easiest two. You can combine them so that we have an ease in out. So it turns out that both of those have basically the same speed at the middle. So we can combine the two. So we're doing ease in at the start and an ease out at the top, and we get a nice accelerate, decelerate, accelerate. Or is it the way around? Decelerate, yes. Slow, fast, slow. It's on there somewhere. Ease in out, quad. And quart is just multiplying. Cubic is to power of 3, quart to power of 4, just giving a sharper curve. And these functions are used all over the place, are well-defined, easy to find. Kivy has them built in, so there's that. Here's an example of animating the X position on something and its size. Kivy is clever enough to say the thing that we're animating is actually a tuple or a list of values, it'll scale all of them. So from whatever the start value is. So whatever the thing is that the widget is that we're animating at the moment, Kivy, when we invoke this animation on it, it saves away the current X and the current size and then animates between them over default duration of 1 second using the in quad tween. So I'm going to... This is where it could all go horribly, horribly wrong. I'm going to show some of this off. So I've got this game called Breakout, right? It's a pretty new groundbreaking sort of game. You might not have heard of it. It's a new thing. And it's come up on the wrong screen. Oh, God. Come on. Okay, so here's Breakout, right? Okay, so it's a bit cheaty, but that's fine. That's not the point. So this is Breakout. It's got walls and it's got blocks and it's not very interesting. Okay, so reset. The first thing we can do is we can add some color, okay? So I'm gonna pretend I'm playing it. So we've added some color. So that's already made it slightly more interesting, right? The walls are red and the blocks are blue and the paddle's green, and that's all very good. We can add some tweening. So if I add, say, a linear tween to bring I animate the blocks coming down, they just come down in a linear fashion, just a constant speed. I can bring them in a quad tween, so they decelerate as they fall in. I can bring them in with a bounce. I can bring them in with a wobble. I can add some random to it. So all of those things, just each block is added with a slightly different start position, slightly different duration, slightly different something that just makes them fall slightly differently, which, just adds that little bit extra. So that's the basics of tweening right there. I'll turn random off so you get a you get a better idea. And that is seriously, that's like one line of code. Animation, block exposition, using in quad, dot start, and it's done. And when it's finished, I'm just gonna reset, that's been crazy. When it's finished, Kivy just gets rid of the animation and it's done. And you don't, it's like fire and forget, you don't have to worry. If you do care about what happens when the animation finishes, you can set an onComplete attribute on the animation object, and that'll be fired when the animation completes, which can be useful to clear something up. Okay, so what else can we add? We can change the ball a little bit. Let's do that. If I say hit this button, the ball will now react when it bounces into something. Again, this is just using tweening. I set the color to white, slightly larger, and I scale it back to its normal size and color. Two lines of, no, this is still one line of code. I'm just animating two properties. I can make the ball rotate to face the direction it's turning. So this is subtle, but it's just a little thing. It just adds that little bit of extra feel to the ball. I can add a trail to the ball, so we can see it zooming around. So that's kind of neat. I can make the blocks react. Hang on, I'll have to reset. Yeah. I can make the blocks react when the ball hits something. They just give that little shudder, and I give it some weight. I can animate the blocks when they've been hit. So we say remove. So that, again, that's just another tween, just animating the size and the color or the opacity. The tail, by the way, that's done using animations, just animating the color away and the, animating the color to red and the opacity to zero. And when the animation is finished, there's an onComplete there to just remove that tail segment from the display. I can add eyes. I can make the eyes follow the ball. Let's see. It's kind of a subtle effect as well, especially when the ball's over there. Yeah, so. And I can add particles. Now, this one isn't going to be that fantastic, unfortunately, because so particles. And again, this one's an easy one to do. It's easy to add. There's a module for Kivy that you can just plug in to add particle effects, and there's a common particle editor that you can use to generate your particle effects. And you can, there's a library of particle effects that you can use. So these are all very simple things. Now, to give you some idea of how easy this is, I started writing this when I got onto the plane in Melbourne, and I finished writing it kind of this morning. I stopped adding stuff, and I just kept adding stuff as I was going. I just added a new thing, added a new thing, added a new thing, and each new thing you add just adds that little something extra to the game. So again, this is, this is what it started out as. Yeah. So, you know, it's just that little bit more interesting as a game. So, it's now 4:30, so 33, which means I'm 10 minutes over. I'd have a little bit more if you want to hang around. Okay. It's entirely up to you. 4:40 is my finish time. I've got 10 minutes, okay. Let's keep going then. Somebody told me 4:20. Okay, so let's talk about, Flappy Bird is a very, very simple game, right? But hey, it made millions. It didn't make millions, it made a lot of money. You know, you just have to capture the imagination somehow. But it has a very simple play area. It's just, it's this one static bit of background that just keeps scrolling, and one bit of foreground that keeps scrolling. There's nothing changes except the pipes, but they're pretty straightforward as well. One of the things we can do in game development is use tile maps to combine a bunch of props, props being very much like, you know, props from telly or the films, where it's just different images that we can plop around the screen in creative ways and we can repeat them, and it's ways we can create interesting scenes. So tile maps reduce the play area down to a grid. In this case, it's a grid that's about 40 cells wide and 40 cells high. Yeah. So each of those squares in the grid is a cell. In this case, the cells are 21 pixels by 21 pixels. It's an odd number, but I'll come to you exactly why for the moment. Cells can be empty or they can have something in them. In this case, they're all empty. There's nothing in those cells. We can put things in those cells. And the things we put in them are tiles. And that's why it's called a tile map. And the tiles come from a thing called a tile set. So in this case, we've used three tiles from our tile set, which has 10 tiles in it. And we've repeated one of the tiles twice in the tile map. And so this is just defining a simple little bit of ground for platform game. The tile set that I've got here came from an enthusiastic bunch of people on Reddit. And it's a free to use open license tile set, and it's actually much larger than just what you see here. The way that you create the tile map is you use a thing called Tiled. It's a program called Tiled, and you get it from mapeditor.org. It's a multi-platform program, and it looks something like this. Resolution scaling is not being kind to me today. So in essence, there's a tile map area, which has got the actual game map in it. We have a bunch of layers. We're only looking at one layer at the moment. And we have a tile set down in the bottom right there. And you can see the tile set has tons of different types of tiles in it that we can use as props in our game. And the tile can have multiple layers, as I said. So at the moment, we're looking at the map layer. And layers can be visible or not. The checkbox indicates whether or not they're visible. And if they're visible in this interface, then they'll be visible when they're rendered in the game. So we can have a background layer as well, which sits on behind the map, and it just has, you know, the landscape background in it. And we can also have a thing called an object layer, which instead of having tiles in it, it can have just arbitrary shaped rectangles and polygons and other things in the object map. I tend to just use rectangles because they map really nicely to the tiles. And you can have tiled snap to the same grid that the tiles are in, which makes it more convenient as well. And you can set properties on the tile, on the objects in the object map as well. So if you, you know, right-click on an object in the map, it'll bring up the properties. You can bring up the properties interface, and you can set a name for it, which is a handy little thing you can see in the interface. But you can also set properties like arbitrary properties like spawn, which I've set to true. And this tells me that this is where the player will spawn in the game. When the game starts, or this level starts, the player will appear. The other blocks in the map, so these blocks here have a property on them called blocker. And it just basically says that, which indicates that the game should block the player's movement if the player hits those blocks. These ones have got platform because they've got blocker set to just block on one side. So they'll block if the player interacts with the top of the platform, but if the player's underneath the platform and comes up, they'll be allowed through. This one over here has a property that says exit. So if you look in the platformer directory, in the Kivy directory I gave you, you should see a thing called, there'll be platformer.py and another .py, I've forgotten what it's called now. Map Explorer. This is Map Explorer. And if you can run Map Explorer if you like. Fingers crossed it'll work. And what it'll allow you to do is just using a touch drag or a mouse drag, allow you to look around a map that's been loaded up, a map from Tiled. And hopefully that will work. You need to be in the platformer directory to do that. Is that? Yeah, that's working for you. Okay. Yeah, so now we're scrolling around. The map has been scaled to fit the display. You can see I've set the scale here to basically be 252, which is the cell size is 21 pixels, and I've scaled it so that 12 cells fits high, the height of the window. That is because that's the Mario height. Again, going back to Mario being kind of the design that everyone goes back to as being one of the great designs of platform gaming, Mario is this high. The levels in Mario are all 12 Marios high, which turns out to be the perfect height to give the player enough room to play in, but also not so much room that they get lost. Games that have less play area displayed tend to feel cramped. If you go down as far as half of that, the player feels incredibly cramped. There was a Commodore 64 game, I think, or an Amiga game called... Oh, I've forgotten it now, something beast. But it had a scale which was about half of this, and it was very unpopular because it felt so cramped. So 12 Mario's high, 12 times the height of your character in the game, or the cell height, because Mario is actually one cell in size. Another thing you might notice here is that this bush looks remarkably similar to this cloud, only it's just green. And it is, in fact, exactly the same image that's been drawn, just in one case it's green. So, you know, saving memory there. Oh, yeah, yeah. So in Kivy, when you've loaded an image, you can set the colour on that image and it will change the hue of that image. So by default, obviously, it's white, which is 111. Yep.
So something I noticed about Kivy, you're saying it draws the window from the bottom left corner?
Yep.
I seem to remember it drawing from the top left. Do you know, like, the decision?
Yeah. So that's because Pygame's kind of old school. So in the bad old days, when, in fact, in the Mario days, computer displays were slightly different. They were raster displays. Okay, hands up if you've owned a raster display, because, you know, there's a bunch of people in here who probably haven't. So raster displays were before we had, you know, LCDs, and they would refresh the screen using a beam of light, a beam of electrons, that scanned across the screen, down a row, across the screen, down a row, across the screen. LCDs used to emulate this, but they don't bother anymore. But the end result of this was that as the beam was drawing, it was pulling straight out of video RAM the value of the color to draw to the screen. So it was reading the video RAM. So the video RAM effectively mapped from here down. And that's why position zero is up here, not down here. But we don't do that anymore. These days, we're much more sensible. So that's pixel mapping. There's also a platformer.py, which you can run, which is a very, very basic implementation of a platformer using Kivy, using the mapping there. When I say very basic, I hadn't got around to actually implementing the exit detection. Feel free to implement it yourself. And feel free to do whatever you want with that. If you want to take that and make a game and make a bazillion bucks out of it, go for it. I don't care. It's just a very simple example of how to write a platform game. Now, if you want to learn more about how that was constructed, my tutorial from last year, which is based in Pygame, talks about the same issues that are needed to implement it for Kivy. So you can go back and watch that video if you like. I only have two more slides. One of them, though, is a demo, which I'm happy to do. Again, it's now actually the end of my tutorial time. So if you'd like, I can give you a demo of a tool that you can use to create pixel art. Yeah? All right, I'll do that. All right, so it's called Pixel Edit. It's not free, sorry. It's but it is cheap. Let me just fire that up. And let's see how it copes with this resolution. God. Yeah. Oh boy. Okay, fortunately I'm going to be creating a very small tile set. So I'm going to create a new 21 pixel by 21 pixel tile set, I'll say 4 tiles wide, 4 tiles high. So I'm creating a tile set that's going to have 16 tiles in it. The pixel dimensions of the tiles are going to be 21 pixels by 21 pixels. Right, so what we've got here is kind of two main areas. We've got a drawing area in the middle, and the other main thing is the actual tile set itself down the bottom right here. Now, the tile set at the moment has nothing in it because I haven't created anything, but as I go, I can add new tiles to the tile set. So what I'm going to do is just very quickly create a simple kind of ground texture. It's going to be the start of a kind of a platform of ground, and then a middle texture, and then an end platform. And you'll see why this is a particularly useful tool for creating those things. So ground, you have kind of like a bit of grass up top, right? I'm going to do this kind of three things wide. So this is going to be one end, this is going to be the middle, this is going to be the other end. Okay, now I'm going to fill that, and then I'm going to draw some lighter grass on top of that. Just randomly, it doesn't matter if I go over the end. Fill that in, and then underneath, I'm going to fill in the medium brown, and then I'm going to draw in some cracks into the ground here, and join them up nicely. So one of the issues that comes in when you're drawing tile mapping tiles for tile sets is joining them up, making sure that they join up nicely and so that they seamlessly tile together. So that's kind of the start of it. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to add these to the tile set. So I'm going to say that these are actually tiles that I want in my tile set down the bottom here. So I go to the tile tool, and one of the nice things about this program is it's got this tooltip here, because there's a bunch of different things you do with the tile tool, and this tooltip reminds you what they all are. Unfortunately for Mac users, where it says control, it means command. So to add a tile from this canvas, if I hit tab, it'll tell me what the tile index is of each of the tiles that I've got displayed up here. At the moment, none of them have a tile index because they're not coming from the tile map. So if I control click or command click for a map on one of these tiles, it'll add it to the tile set. And you can see that it's added 1, 2, 3 tiles to the tile set down here. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that middle tile, and I'm going to plop it up here. And I'll take the end tile, and I'll plop it here. Because what I've got to do is I've got to make these things seamlessly tiled together. So let's see, if I take this guy here and draw it up here, and I take this guy and draw it over there, you can see that it's replicating the change on the other copy of the tile. That right there makes this the thing you want to use for making tile sets. So at this point, I can go in and I can add in some highlights. I'm really not a very good tile artist, so, whatever. Add in some extra bits here. I've kind of stuffed this up a little bit. I need another bit of dark down there. There's not enough dark down there. So if I alt-click, I can do a color pick from the thing. Okay, so we're going to whack that there. Now, so this is my end tile, so I need to actually clear this up a bit. So I'm going to take a little bit off the end here, and then I'm going to chop that up there and go in one there, go around, and then out there. There's obviously a bunch of cleanup that I could do here, but chop that in there, chop that. Around. Ugh, this is the worst. All right, switch back to the drawing thingy. But one of the things you can see is over on the side here, that's actual size rendering what I'm actually drawing. So I can see what the end result of this will be, which is actually it's the worst. Oh my God. But I'm happy to admit it. So if I say that, does that make it better? Yeah, it makes it slightly better. Yeah, a little bit, not really. Yeah. If I grab some of this here and kind of add a little bit of extra there and a little bit of that there and maybe a little bit of that there, a bit of that there. there. Oh, that's a little bit better. Yeah, it's starting to get there. Anyway, so that's very basically how you use tiled. You're grabbing tiles from down here, and you're plopping them up in here, and you see how they tile together. So you can see when I put these two together, there's actually a bit of a transition here that's maybe not quite right. So I could actually go in and I can change that a little bit. But you can see now when it transitions to this one, not quite right, but I don't know, I could just add a little bit there, and that's okay. Yeah. Yeah, so that ability to have the view and the editing and seeing how the tiling is going together is really powerful. And obviously, for a real tile set where you've got to have bits underneath as well, you can build up the whole thing and see how they all tile together and make those edits directly here. The other thing that tile does, which I'm not going to get into now because I'm actually way over time, is you can edit animations. So you can instead of having this being frames instead of having this as each of these cells being images from a tile set that are just static in a tile set, you can say actually they're frames from an animation, and then down the bottom here you can see that animation being played, and so you can make little edits to the animation. So you've got a figure that's running, or an explosion that's going off, or whatever the animation might be—a bird that's flapping. You can see how that animation plays out in real as you're making the edits, and you can see that animation playing. So it's really powerful. If you're going to get into doing game development, even just as a hobby, this just makes it so much more fun. And there's heaps of tutorials out there that are way better at it than me. And you can pick up lots of really good tips about drawing pixel art from tutorials as well. So I highly recommend them. So yeah, just a very, very quick overview of what pixel edit is. So from here, kivy.org is the place to go if you want to keep doing Kivy. If you run into trouble and you happen to be in a European-ish time zone, then the Kivy developers are almost always on Kivy, the channel Kivy on Freenode IRC, and they are very helpful. If you're interested in Pygame, there's Pygame. Piglet, there's the other library, piglet.org. If you want to have another crack at learning how to write slightly different types of games, using Pygame, then Invent with Python has free books. They're great for kids. Actually, they're kind of aimed at kids, that's a good free resource. And PyWeek is a biannual game programming challenge that I run, and the next one will be run in May-ish, late May. I'm not sure yet because I'm kind of busy at the start of May. We'll see how we go. So PyWeek, it's great fun. You write a game from scratch in a week. And as I said right at the start, the important thing about writing games is you write a bunch of them, and the ones you write at the start suck, and they get better, and you just keep going at it, and it's a hell of a lot of fun as you're doing it. So that's all I've got to say. So thank you for coming.